Hello all, welcome to this new lecture. In this video, we will discuss lossy compression. So in lossy compression, we achieve more compression with the exchange of the reduction in the image information. That means the accuracy of the constructed image will be less and we will achieve more compression in the lossy. So in many lossy encoding techniques in which the reproduced image is recognizable, that can achieve the compression up to 100:1. That means 100 times less information will be taken by the image which is compressed by using lossy compression. Now, but some techniques which shows very little indistinguishable image from the original image, that can achieve 10:1 to 50:1 compression ratio. That means 10 times less information to 50 times less information compression ratio, which we can achieve by using lossy compression, and in which we will not be able to distinguish between the original image and the compressed image. So, and this compression ratio which we achieve here, that is in the range 10:50:1 in the lossy compression, it is 3:1 in the lossless compression. That means that two very rarely achieved. So this is the advantage we get in the lossy compression. So the amount of memory required to store the image will be saved a lot here in the lossy compression. So while discussing the redundancies, I discussed about the psychovisual redundancy. In that, I have discussed about the quantization. So I have discussed there that the quantization is the irreversible process. So if we use quantizer in the image compression process, then that their information will be lost. Some information will be lost. So that is why that is called lossy compression. So the difference between lossy and lossless compression will be from this quantizer block. If we are using quantizer block in the compression, then that is called lossy compression. If we do not use quantization in the compression, then that is called lossless compression. Since the only block which leads to information loss, that is quantizer. So that is the only difference between lossy and lossless compression. Now, first lossless compression we will discuss is predictive coding, lossy predictive coding. So in this, what do? We use one predictor. So based on the previous predictions and the error, it predicts the current intensity value. And this intensity value will be subtracted from, this predicted value will be subtracted from original image value. And here we will get the error, that is EN. Then this EN will be passed through a quantizer. So this error will be mapped to another range of errors. Now this will be mapped to another range of errors, and this is the task of quantizer. So this quantizer will reduce the psychovisual redundancies from the data. Now this error will be used to store into the. So before storing this, what is done? This is given to the symbol encoder. So symbol encoder, what it will do? It will encode this error into the variable length coding. So the coding redundancies will be reduced from the data, and that variable length code will be stored into the memory, and that is how we achieve the compression. So we will get compressed image after this. So here we can understand. So here is the input image. Here is the predicted value of that particular pixel. This we will get original image pixel. It is the predicted value of the pixel. Here we will get error. That will be input for the quantizer. Quantizer will map it to the another range, and this error will go as the input for symbol encoder, as well as this will be added to the previous pixel prediction, so that we can get an input for the predictor. So this predictor will predict the next pixel value based on the previous prediction and the previous error which we had got. So that will be input for this predictor, and that will be given to the predictor, and based on this input the predictor will predict the current intensity value. Now next comes, how does this predictor works? So the input of the predictor, that is f dot n, that is given as x, this error, that is e dot n, plus the previous prediction, that is f cap n. So this is given as the input, and based on this input it will predict some value for the current pixel value. Now the prediction can be in this form. A type of predictor is this one. So the predicted value is equal to alpha times the previous value. Alpha times the previous value, or f dash n minus 1. So alpha is a constant here, and f dash n minus 1 is this value. So based on the previous prediction and the previous error, we get a input here, and that is multiplied by some constant, that is the current prediction that we get out of predictor. Then the quantizer can be defined like this. One type of quantizer is e dot n, that is equal to plus eta if the error is greater than zero. If this error is greater than zero, then it is equal to plus eta, otherwise it is minus eta. So the advantage of using this kind of quantizer is, since we have only two types of error, that is plus eta or minus eta, so this can be represented only by using one bit. Only by using one bit we can mention this error, or we can code this error only by using one bit. So this is one example of quantizer. It is not necessary that this quantizer only is used. Different kind of quantizers can be used, and based on that, whatever output we get here, that is given as the input to the symbol encoder, and then here in symbol encoder, whatever coding we do, that will give us the compressed image. So this is the encoder part of lossy predictive coding. So hope this is clear. Then in decoder, what we do, we decompress the compressed image. So the compressed image will be given to this symbol decoder. So the inverse of symbol encoder is symbol decoder. So when we do inverse of that, we will get the error from which we had stored, right? Error we will get which we had stored, and the same predictor we will use, this predictor which we had used in the encoder, we will use in the decoder too. So same predictor will be used, and based on the previous decompressed image values, it will predict the current coefficient, and the difference of these two will be taken to achieve the decompressed image, or to get the decompressed image coefficients. So here, since I have told that quantization is an irreversible process, so the law corresponding to quantizer will not be there in the decoder. That means whatever operations we have performed here in the quantizer, that cannot be reversed. So that block will not appear in the decoder. So here, parameterized block will not be there. Remaining all blocks will be there. So this symbol encoder is here. So reverse of this is symbol decoder. And here we had used predictor, same predictor we have used, and the difference of error and this predicted values will be taken to get the decompressed image coefficients. So this will be arranged back and we will get the original image back. So this is the way we compress and decompress the image using the lossy predictive code. Hope this is clear. Now next is transform coding. In transform coding, so here if we see, then the input image coefficients are directly given to the encoder. This is directly given to the encoder. So this is a, we can say, spatial operation, spatial domain operation. In transform coding, what do? We perform a reversible linear transform on the image coefficients. And then the transform coefficients are quantized and coded. This is how we achieve the compression in the transform coding. So what do? We take the image, we perform some transformation on the, this can be Fourier transform, wavelet transform, or any other transform too. We get the transform coefficient, and from transform coefficient we perform quantization on the transform coefficient. We are performing the quantization, and the quantized coefficients will be coded, right? So this is the process we follow in the transform coding. So how the compression and decompression is achieved in transform coding? We have the input image, that is n cross n. The dimension of the image is n cross n. This image is subdivided into sub-images. This is divided into sub-images. So this will be divided into n cross n, small n cross small n sub-images. And then on every sub-image, what we do? We take the sub-image and we perform transform on that sub-image. We perform the forward transform on that sub-image. So this transformation for natural images, several coefficients of this forward transform will be very small. Those coefficients can be discarded, or those coefficients can be coarsely quantized by using quantizer. So by doing so, we will be able to achieve a good compression without losing much of information. So the work of forward transform is to decorrelate the image pixel values, and then by doing this, what do? We remove the interpixel redundancy. Then the output of forward transform, that is transform coefficients, that will be given to the quantizer. So what will quantizer do? These small coefficients will be coarsely quantized, or they will be discarded. So the small coefficients will not contain much information in the forward transform coefficients. So those will be discarded, or those will be coarsely quantized. So by doing so, what we will do? We will be able to reduce the psychovisual redundancy, and the output of this quantizer will be given to symbol encoder. So in symbol encoder, usually variable length coding is done, and in variable, by doing the variable length coding, we remove the coding redundancy and we get the compressed image. So this is how the image compression is achieved in the transform coding. And how do we decompress the image? The compressed image is first given to symbol decoder. So this is inverse of symbol encoder. So what it will do? It will give us the value which we had achieved from the quantizer. So this we will get here. Then, since we know that there is no inverse log for the quantizer, so whatever data we lose or we change during the quantizer, that cannot be retrieved back. So there is no block in the inverse process for the quantizer. So whatever data we get here, that on that data we perform the inverse transformation. So the inverse of Fourier transformation will be inverse transform, and then it will be done for all the sub-images, and then all those sub-images will be merged to get the original capital N cross capital N image, and that will be our decompressed image. So this is how we perform compression and decompression with the transform coding. So here are some of the points for the transform coding. I will read out these. So the first is, for most natural images, a significant number of coefficients have small magnitude and can be coarsely quantized, discarded entirely with the little image distortion. So this we already have discussed. After taking the transformation, some coefficients will be very small. They can be discarded or they can be coarsely quantized without losing much of information, or without with a little distortion. Then second point is, this N cross N input image first is subdivided into sub images of small n cross small n, which are then transformed to generate n by capital N by small n square sub image transform arrays, each of size n cross n. So if we divide it by n cross n by small n cross n, then we will get n by small n square number of sub images. Then the goal of transformation process is to decorrelate the pixel of each sub-image. So by doing transformation, what do we achieve? We decorrelate the pixels. So interpixel redundancy will be removed from by using the transformation process. Or by doing so, what do we achieve? Or to pack as much information as possible into the smallest number of transform coefficients. So here, as we have discussed, that some of the coefficients will be very small, so they can be discarded. So the information will be packed into the coefficients which are little larger. So those coefficients, so the information will be packed into those small number of transform coefficients. Now the quantization stage then selectively eliminates more coarsely quantized coefficients that carry the least information. So next comes the quantization stage. What it does actually is it will eliminate the coefficients which are carrying least information. That means which have the least magnitude. They will be eliminated, or they will be coarsely quantized. So by doing so, what we do, we achieve the psychovisual redundancy. We reduce the psychovisual redundancy. After that, we use the encoding. The encoding process terminates by coding, normally using a variable length code, the quantized coefficient. So the quantized coefficient will be given to the symbol encoder. This symbol encoder that will perform variable length code, and that will give us the compressed image. So this is how we encode the image. We compress the image by using transform coding. And any or all of the transform encoding steps can be adapted to local image content, called adaptive transform coding, or fixed for all sub-images, called non-adaptive transform coding. So if we have, like, we have got these sub-images, so if we have different these steps for different sub-images, that means it is adaptive to each image. Then we say it is adaptive transform coding. then it is adaptive transformer. Or if all these steps are same for all the sub-images, then we say it is called non-adaptive transformer. Okay, so that's it for this lecture. We will meet in the next lecture. Thank you.